Conventional thinking in astronomy has been that the early universe did not have much in the way of planets. Without planets, there is no conceivable habitability. But that may be more complicated than it might seem, more on that in a bit. The Big Bang did not initially create the elements needed for planets. Rather, only after a period of supernovae and star formation occurred did the heavier elements needed for the process come into being. As a result, the earliest planets were thought to have formed about 1 billion years after the Big Bang. Again, conventional thinking would be that this 1 billion years after the Big Bang, this period was a whopping 12.8 billion years ago, is seen as generally the earliest date that life in the universe could have arisen under perfect conditions. But I say generally because there could have been situational conditions where a local early supernova might have yielded material for an early star system with habitability. But somewhere around that point, there is a limit. But there is an oddity in that the early universe had an epoch about 10 to 17 million years after the Big Bang, when the entire universe was habitable as far as temperature. It was the point where the universe had collectively cooled enough for liquid water, if it had been present, to remain liquid on all planetary surfaces. That's just a question of temperature, though. Because for anything to have happened, you'd have needed planetary surfaces, and that age seems implausibly early for such a thing. But a billion years after the Big Bang, sure. But there, the rules on habitability and temperature more resemble what we have now. All we really know about habitable worlds is that as soon as Earth possibly could have been habitable, life appears. Before then, the planet was just too molten and inhospitable. But about 3.8 or even 4 billion years ago, life simply appears. That means that a star system with a planet like our own can become habitable about 600 million years after its formation. After all, that's what happened here. But it is also possible for smaller planets to have cooled faster, such as Mars, that might have sported habitability before Earth did. But one must be careful there because young sun-like stars are less luminous, they get brighter as they age, leading to the faint young sun paradox. We really have no idea how Earth managed to stay warm enough for life so early in the solar system's history, with the sun being so much dimmer. It was 30% dimmer than it is now. That's a lot less solar radiation hitting the surfaces of Earth and Mars. We don't have the answer to that mystery, but given the ambiguity, and frankly unclarity, about just when planets that might have supported life in the universe first appeared, it's clear the debate on this is not yet over. It's gotten deeper recently. In a paper by Daniel Whalen and colleagues, link in the description below, they revised just when it was plausible for it to happen. It turns out, it may have been far earlier than the 1 billion years after the Big Bang mark. Indeed, it may have happened before the first galaxies truly formed. The assumption up until now has been that the galaxies formed first, but this may not actually be the case. Habitable worlds may have. So just after the Big Bang, there were no heavy elements. There was just hydrogen, helium, and small amounts of lithium and beryllium. Less than 1%, in fact. Whereas hydrogen was something like 75%, and helium most of the rest. That's not enough material to form a rocky planet. As an aside, this rule does not hold for gas giants. When the first of those appear in the universe is somewhat murky. There is a gas giant known as PSR B1620-26b that is surprising on several fronts. The first is that it's located in a binary system orbiting a pulsar and a white dwarf. But that system is inside a globular cluster, which is unusual to say the least. There was a point where that was thought to be highly unlikely. But more, the exoplanet's age is estimated to be about 12.7 billion years old, based on observations by Hubble and JWST. That was thought to be too early as well. That's again, about a billion years after the Big Bang. Yet that planet exists, and may have formed at a time when gas giants were possible, but the mechanism for their formation and their composition is very different from a gas giant that formed later, like Jupiter. This is interesting because there are some hypotheses, including one by Carl Sagan back in the day, that there may be a kind of habitability possible in the upper atmosphere of a gas giant. It's speculative, but gas giant atmospheres are not ruled out as potential abodes for life. But back to terrestrial worlds. The paper goes into the idea of the first supernovae. These are termed primordial supernovae, and they were when the first stars in the universe that were massive enough to do it exploded. In the aftermath, low-mass stars formed from the materials ejected in the supernova. Then the process of planet formation could have occurred. Basically, everything starts to clump together. You get planetesimals, and they clump and collide until you have terrestrial worlds, some of which could have been in the habitable zones of those second-generation stars. The team noted that this all happened before the first galaxies formed. The modeling looks like this. Imagine a star forming in the early universe that has about 200 times more mass than the Sun. This would mean that it would only exist as a star for about 2.6 million years before burning through its initial fuel. That means it will explode as a supernova because its equilibrium changed. As the bubble of material expands out from the supernova, it's enriched by heavier elements formed in the star and during the explosion. After this, a dense core of about 35 solar masses forms. The researchers note that this fills all the requirements for planet formation, including dust characteristics and the ability for planetesimals to form up. Where this is different from today, however, is that when a primordial supernova cooked off, the gas cloud, rich in heavier elements, cooled faster, which means stars could form sooner within it, and also planets. Eventually, the model showed a protostar forming, a small one, only about 0.3 solar masses, followed by planets. Interestingly, the simulation also showed that an early star system like this would have had about as much water as the solar system had when it formed, since the supernova remnant would have contained carbon, oxygen, and other elements all the way up to iron. That's all you need for a planet with water as long as it's within the habitable zone of the star. All of this could have happened before the formation of the first galaxies, at least as we know them. Proving this will be interesting because it's possible. So the team lays out that these ancient planets can be looked for around metal-poor stars, of which we know of quite a few in the Milky Way. They even suggest that even earlier planets might have formed if the conditions were right, meaning that it's possible that as little as 650 million years after the Big Bang, there may have already been rocky planets, with a very, very early possible conditional date of 200 million years after the Big Bang. Another thing that needs to be done is an observation of a primordial supernova and its aftermath. This is beyond difficult, and even beyond what the James Webb Telescope likely can do. Granted that looking deeper into the universe is looking backwards in time, these primordial supernovae would be extremely distant and faint. The very first generation of stars in the universe are known as Population 3 stars, and we have yet to observe any of them, though there are several candidates. Without a definitive detection of one, then we don't know their masses, average lifetimes, and even the supernova explosion mechanisms of these types of stars is unclear. It may simply be due to the differences in composition to modern stars. All that's really known is that there had to be a first generation of stars, and they had to have undergone supernovae for us to get to the point we are in the universe. It all had to start somewhere. Just 200 million years after the Big Bang is really early for a planet that might have life. If microbial life had arisen on such a world that early, it's possible that a civilization could have developed extraordinarily early in the history of the universe. We don't actually know how long it takes on average for life to reach intelligence. We simply know how long it took here on Earth. But there are ideas where, if by luck, the process were streamlined somehow, a civilization could evolve and appear on a world in significantly less time than it happened here on Earth. But it's also possible that Earth was a fluke and ended up with a civilization far earlier than most planets do, and that the answer to the Fermi paradox is simply that we're very early in the game, and that there isn't anyone else out there yet. But in the future, there will be, leading potentially to an explosion of intelligent life in the universe, relegating us to the position of being the ancient ones. Potentially, even the ancient extinct ones. Given that nothing lasts forever, it may even be the case that during the intelligence explosion in the universe, no one ever knows that we were even ever here. Maybe that's the case for us, and the universe once had other advanced civilizations, but they are simply gone now, giving the appearance of a great silence. But with the dating of the earliest habitable planets being pushed back further and further into the early universe, a few hundred million years after the Big Bang, it's interesting to wonder what that civilization, if one ever existed, thought of astronomy, because in many ways the universe was somewhat different back then. Regardless, there wouldn't have been much in the way of materials in their neighborhood overall, just hydrogen and helium, meaning there would not have been much of a reason to engage in deep space exploration, when all you were likely to find within reachable distance was empty star systems at best, and not even a coherent galaxy yet, all in a much more contracted universe. One wonders what their scientists would have predicted about the future of the universe where we live now. But what pushing the clock back for a hypothetical life does do is further complicate the Fermi paradox, making the Great Silence that much more deafening. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the early aliens if they existed. I'm not sure they would have even had a Fermi paradox. They just look out, see the state of the early universe, and conclude they were a fluke. They would have been one of the few civilizations in the universe so far that would not necessarily have had a reason to think that they were anything but alone, or at least functionally so from a scientific standpoint. Interesting. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.